You'll see from the title that today's webinar is around the changing landscape of real estate. And you'll also see from the cameras here that I'm joined by a panel of people who will introduce themselves in just a moment. But I'd just like to say before I do move on to the actual slides is you will notice that you're joining us with your camera off and your microphone off, and that's just to keep these guys concentrating on the slides so that we don't distract them. Sometimes we have noise coming through from people's background, so if you could keep them like that, that would be great. I'd also like to thank those that are watching us back at a later date as well. We do realise, and we were just discussing there, that a lot of you guys do choose to watch the webinar back at a later date. So we know it's a valuable tool, so we do appreciate that. So thank you very much for doing so. So you'll notice the chat function as well if you've never used Zoom before or you've never been on a webinar. And we do encourage you to send through your questions using the chat function. I will pitch them to Mark and the panel towards the end of the session. So if you do have some questions around what these guys are talking about or some questions around the course, please do send them through. Okay, so who am I? Well, my name is Craig Donaldson and I am the course advisor. So I do manage a number of our online and blended learning courses, such as the real estate one. And generally what my role is I will answer any questions you have around the application process. So this could be questions around the fees, your eligibility, how to fill the application form in, or just general questions around the course that I can answer. And if not, I can reach out to Mark and get some information for you. So you can also see as well that I am available for any consultations that you might want to have. You might choose to want to contact me over Zoom. Please feel free to do so, and I'll share my contact details towards the end of the session. So this is our panel. As you can see there, we've got an existing student, we've got our course director and some of our alumni. So I won't talk about them. I will let those guys do that themselves. And first up, Mark.
Hi everybody, my name's Mark Shepherd. I'm the program director for this program. I guess what you need to know about me is that I have a background in practice as well as academia, and I think the content and delivery of the course reflects that, because that is a reflection of the team as well. And I'll be talking you a bit more through the program itself shortly, but you know, if you have any questions, do put them in the chat and I'm happy to answer them at the end.
Thanks, Mark. So moving on, we have Elizabeth.
Hi, everyone. I'm Elizabeth. I'm currently a master's in real estate student at Manchester, but I am a distance learning student. So this is part-time over 2 years. I'm also an investment analyst at British Land, where I work on property acquisitions and disposals across the company's retail and office portfolios. And if you've never heard of BL before, it's one of the largest REITs in the UK, and we focus on development and investment, where we, you know, sell off off-strategy assets to fund our large-scale development projects. And I guess my previous degree was financial mathematics at the University of Surrey.
Thanks, Elizabeth. Hattie.
Hi, everyone. I'm Hattie. A bit about my background. So I originally studied psychology and quickly realised this was not for me. So at the end of my first year, I just wanted to try something completely different. So I studied international business at a summer school in Brazil and realised this was the route I wanted to take. So I did loads of research, and then at the end of my second year, I did an internship in commercial property at Cushner Wakefield and loved this. So knew being a non-cognate, I needed to do a degree that was RICS accredited. So then did my master's at University of Manchester, and I'm now a graduate surveyor at Cushman & Wakefield on my first rotation in public sector. So mainly working with central local governments, universities, NHS and other different government bodies.
That's great. Thanks, Hattie. Hi, Connor.
Hi, guys. I am an asset manager currently working for Bruntwood Works in Manchester. For those who don't know, Bruntwood Works are a commercial landlord that have assets in the Northwest, Yorkshire and the Midlands. Similar to Hattie, previously I studied a different subject, studied history, and then kind of decided that wasn't really for me, took a bit of time out and decided to study real estate development at Manchester. and I graduated in 2018.
Thanks, Connor. Okay, so that is our panel. And we've got a number of questions that I think Mark is going to pitch to our panel. And we'll get the kind of answers around what it, I guess, the questions that Mark and I have put together. And we'll see if this information is useful for you guys who are considering applying for the course. Okay, Mark, can I hand over to you at this point?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Craig. So, I mean, one of the things we asked our students and alumni to share with you is, you know, how has the master's impacted? They're all in the real estate industry. So how has the master's contributed to that entry to an engagement with a career in real estate? So do we have an order, Craig, of...
I think we were going to pitch to Elizabeth first of all, I think, and then come to Hattie and Connor in that order.
Excellent. So I'll stop talking and hand over to you guys if you don't mind.
So as I mentioned before, my first degree was actually in financial mathematics. So going into real estate was actually quite new for me. You can never take away on-the-job training, but studying alongside my day-to-day job at the moment kind of puts things into perspective. So it kind of brings your skill set, your industry knowledge and academia all together. It does complement my day job working in investment. So, for example, you have a module in property valuation and investment in finance, and that goes into the deeper theory behind what we do and basically how we do it. I know each business has different strategies, but the theory is ultimately the most important thing about your job. And for example, although Excel and Argus are used for complex valuations and finding investment returns, for example, the course actually enables you to think critically and make well, you know, justified decisions and provide a solid foundation of the industry. It's been very, very helpful for me so far. Yeah.
Oh, that's great. Thanks, Elizabeth. And I think next up, Connor, was it yourself who was going to give your overview of that question?
Yeah, I can go next. I think for me, the biggest part that prepared me for my career so far is probably, as I mentioned, not coming from a property or real estate background. I was quite fresh to a lot of the topics that we were learning. But the course provides like the fundamentals required for your career, whatever that may be. And I think because the course covers quite like a wide range of topics, it actually helps you identify what you want to do, like which sort of pathway you want to go down, whether like Elizabeth is currently doing investment, myself, I do asset management. So you kind of get a taste of each and then you can kind of decide from there. So for me, that was really important. Another big thing that helped, I think, is the link between what you learn in theory and going on in practice, that it's encouraged that you, in your assessments and your projects, that you actually look in the market at what is happening and how those examples can be utilised in your study.
That's great. Thanks, Connor. Hattie, I can see you somewhere down there. Can you give us your opinion of how the course has helped you into your career as well?
Yeah, definitely. Echoing what Connor said, it was also completely new to me. A lot like very different from my previous discipline. And it was also good that I found that a lot of the course elements, you actually need them and are kind of core elements when you do your APC. So they align really well, provides really good preparation if that's the route that you want to go down to do this course. I also found that the practical elements were really good. So we got let loose on an office building and had to measure that up. That's something that I've, you know, used to do fairly regularly when I was in the office. Likewise, there's a placement element. So there's an opportunity to do a placement, I think, at the start of the year. And I just contacted Cushman & Wakefield and did a placement that way and then was offered a job. So that worked out well. So I think the placement element's really good, as well as this and just their general links to employers. It's well respected. So it's good in that sense as well.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks, Hattie. Okay, I think this is our next question, Mark.
Okay, thanks, Craig. So we thought it'd be helpful if each of us shared something about our our particular areas. So each one of us is going to contribute a little bit about the impact of the current situation on these individual areas. So I think if we're starting with land and development, Hattie, do you mind taking that one forward?
Sorry, I've done the classic, was on mute. Yeah, that's fine. So something I wanted to pick up on was just the changes that we're gonna see as a result of COVID. So yeah, one of the big things is that we're all working from home at the moment. So there's obvious negatives to this, but I think there's also some really good opportunities. So we've all got used to the lack of commute and the flexibility that this offers, and it's kind of accelerated a change and shifted thinking that would have taken like 10 plus years to achieve, because we've all taken part in this mass home working experiment. And I think it'll be interesting to see how commercial landlords and businesses respond to this. So at the moment, the changes seem to just be quite short term. So like my office, we've got glass screens, we limit contact where possible. But I think it'll be interesting to think about the lasting changes. So the days of kind of going into the office to kind of do work, I think will be gone. I think we'll go in for a specific purpose, so client meetings or collaboration, and landlords will have to think about what will need to change in order to meet these changes in the way we use them. So previously you would have had kind of long rows of desks, with people just working, but actually you need to move to high quality space that people actually want to travel to, space to collaborate, work with clients. So something that an employee can't really get from working at home. Another discussion is, in addition to this main office space in city centres, potentially having kind of smaller hubs and satellite offices closer to where people actually live. So if it was Manchester, there might be areas like Chorlton, Didsbury, Altrincham, and offer things like good Wi-Fi, a good coffee, proper desk. So people get that networking and social element, which equally they can't get when working at home. Yeah, similar to like a WeWork model, but on a much smaller scale. So I think it'll be interesting to see what long-term changes happen as a result of everything going on. And another area I wanted to touch on was health. So living through a pandemic, we've all become far more aware of our own health and how much we actually rely on the NHS. So in 2017, there was a poll to find out how many people would be in favour of a 1% tax increase, which would fund the NHS, and it was found that 43% were in favour of this. They revisited it in 2019 and this had increased to 56%. So I think it'd be really interesting to revisit that now and see what the attitude is like, considering we've had this kind of national appreciation for the NHS, indicated by how much money we all raised in lockdown and other things like the NHS clap. So the hope is that this increase in public appreciation will kind of influence the government to make it more of a political priority. So in terms of what I do, so public sector team in Cushing & Wakefield, we do a lot of work with the NHS, and frequently we'll look at a region's health estate, and a common issue is it's just not fit for purpose. It was built in the 70s, large amounts of backlog maintenance, which year on year, they just kind of patch up. So COVID has meant there's already been quite a lot of investment in the short term. So the Nightingale hospitals, which have increased capacity, investment in digital services, so online GP appointments, these will likely continue, and these changes have kind of been accelerated because there's a demand right now. So I think it's a real opportunity. It's shown that things can happen quickly, and the hope is that in the long term this continues and the NHS kind of gets the investment that it really needs.
That's great. Thank you, Hattie. Appreciate that. I think that definitely reflects a common experience. So I'll take the next topic about property valuation, and I'll keep it brief, but I think there are two aspects of this, and Hattie's touched on some of this in particular, but it's changing the profession and it's changing the market. So how is it changing the profession? I think there are a lot more desktop valuations, and also what they used to call when I was in mortgage valuation, drive-by valuations, which sounds a lot more sinister than it really is, where you're relying much more heavily on information from third parties or historic information, rather than the sort of primary data that you would normally go and collect for yourself from the property by viewing it. I think where we do have to go and do inspections, we're having to use a lot more personal protective equipment and getting to grips with that around the technicalities of measuring and surveying buildings is an interesting challenge. People are telling me that they're video conferencing a lot more with clients, for example, rather than meeting them in person. And I think the challenge of this remote working, particularly for valuation, is that often valuers like to discuss and throw ideas around and kind of, you know, get advice from their colleagues, especially where, you know, you're perhaps not the senior valuer and you want to get the opinion of a colleague, whilst, you know, online on Teams or Zoom is fine. It's not the same as sitting down and having a proper chat, perhaps with a group of colleagues, and exploring the issues face to face. There's something about that is difficult to capture electronically. So I think, again, as Hattie said, you know, as the use of offices change, we are still going to be going in for things like meetings. I mean, from a valuation point of view, we're in a period of what should we say? Well, let's say distinct uncertainty. It's complicated. There's a phrase, VUCA. I don't know whether you come across this: volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. And I think that very much characterizes where we're at right now. I think there are a number of processes being accelerated, as Hattie absolutely rightly said, but I think there are different areas at different points in the cycle. So, you know, we look at the challenges faced by the hospitality industry, the retail industry, and yet if we look at, I don't know, life sciences, health, financial technology, they are doing particularly well at the moment. It's interesting to look at the impact on heavy industry, for example, where there are some challenges because of, for example, global supply issues, and therefore the implications that has for their productivity. And because inevitably there's a lack of market activity for all sorts of reasons. From a valuation point of view, there's a lack of transactional evidence, certainly in some areas, and also people are delaying decisions because of, you know, VAT holidays, furlough, business rates holidays, and all sorts of things, which perhaps when they come to an end will start to trigger sales and trigger transactions. But people still need valuations in the interim. And the challenge is, you know, finding that data in a meaningful way. And certainly the RICS has been publishing guidance recently about the issue around material uncertainty. This is where uncertainty goes beyond the sort of traditional margin of error that's legitimate, given that, you know, it's a professional judgment about a likely transaction price, probably. Whereas, you know, in periods where we really don't necessarily know what's going to happen as a result of COVID, you know, people were ambiguous about whether there'd be a second lockdown, for example. Look at where we are in England right now. So because we're operating in that situation, I think there's a lot more due diligence going on, if anything, than there used to be, because we're having to check and double check and review everything, because often we're getting it secondhand rather than collecting it ourselves. But we're also having to make judgments in conditions of quite extreme uncertainty. And so I think that challenges the experience and the knowledge and the professionalism of the valuer to address that. So I think that's all I want to say about property valuation. Connor, could I hand over to you to talk about asset management?
Yeah, of course. I think, without being the voice of doom, I think there's a lot of challenges at the minute within asset management. The biggest challenge really is trying to minimise risk for landlords and investors. I think, as Mark touched on, not knowing when this will end and sort of the changing, the goalposts changing in terms of lockdown and stuff like that makes it more difficult for landlords. And for example, I think in terms of minimising risk, one of the biggest challenges is trying to reduce void periods in portfolios, especially in the office market at the minute. As Hattie touched on, that there's this movement to a work from home model, which seems to be quite favourable at the minute and doesn't seem to be going away. It seems to be getting stronger every day. And that in itself is causing problems with office take-up, especially in Manchester. In Q3, the office take-up was 70% below the 10-year average, which is quite a substantial difference. And any sort of landlord that has a portfolio with significant void and vacancy, they'll be up against more competition now. So they might have to invest more capital into their assets to be more competitive. Again, with the sort of social distancing regulations, they'll need to ensure that their buildings are fit for purpose as well. So there are a lot of obstacles to overcome with offices. Again, though, I think Hattie did touch on it. One of the emerging opportunities offices is the sort of out-of-town areas. As people don't want to be travelling on public transport, they want to reduce that commute. Areas such as like Altrincham, Bolton, sort of wider region areas, that they are seeing more traction and more interest from occupiers as they want to get like satellite offices which meet the needs of their employees. I think one of the other biggest challenges at the minute also lies with retail. As we know from the start, retail has been hit quite heavily, the reduced footfall and the restrictions on shops opening. I feel like landlords with huge amounts of retail assets in their portfolio will have some serious obstacles to overcome over the next few months. A big contentious issue at the minute has been CVAs with retailers. Retailers nowadays are going for CVAs quite enthusiastically. Pete's Hut was one of the biggest ones where they managed to agree to close 29 sites. However, there are some opportunities in retail. There's been a reform to the town and country planning use class order, which has meant that previous retail assets can now be utilised for various other uses under use class E. I think for landlords, especially in out-of-town high streets, this will make it easier for them to diversify their assets, which again will offset any risk. And then I think to finish off, the biggest opportunity probably lies within the industrial market. The industrial market's seen a lot of take up this year and hasn't been affected by the COVID virus at all, really. So for those landlords that do have industrial assets in their portfolio, they might see this as an opportunity to redevelop, make their assets more competitive as the demand grows. So we'll just have to see what happens.
Excellent. Thanks, Connor. Appreciate that. So last but not least, Elizabeth, could you fill us in a little bit on investment, please?
Yep. So I will touch on offices and retail, my main two focuses that I work in at British Land. And it goes without saying that land and development, property valuation and asset management all kind of come together for investment. All of those won't actually exist without investment, essentially, and vice versa. So on the offices side, I guess at the beginning, you know, we had from a investment volumes perspective, we had quite a few deals being pulled out from the market, I guess, the sheer nervousness and, you know, most of them waiting and seeing what's going to happen. But that's in March. And as you know, today's lockdown 2.0. So it's actually been a little bit worse. So from Q2 to Q3, for example, there actually was a bit of a turnover increase. Well, we actually traded about 1.25 billion in just the London market alone. And that's just because we actually had a bit of a opening of general stores and people outside a bit more, a few people going into the office a few days in the week, for example. And this has actually created quite a lot of demand for investors, especially from German investors. We've seen quite a lot of activity from the Asian markets, who are actually quite quiet at the very, very beginning of lockdown. But at the moment, as at today, there's about 4.4 billion worth of product available in just London. And I think it's been quite resilient, despite the fact that everyone is at home at the moment. It's because we can actually operate at home, or most offices or most large companies are still able to operate from home. So that meant that they're still able to pay their rent. They're still making those revenues that they need in order to pay their rent, as an example. But I guess going forward for the offices market and any investor who actually wants to buy office buildings, they probably have to shy away from the traditional buying a building and just collecting income. There'll be quite a lot of asset management in initiatives, you know, maybe short leases and maybe leases not as long as 35 years, for example. I just don't think that would exist anymore, because most people probably want smaller space, enough to fill people, well, office workers, 3 to 5 days, well, 3 to 4 days a week might be pushing it. So I think it will kind of go down to 2 to 3 days a week. You kind of see those changes, and then you start to see the changes in the strategies of investors and what they actually want from the offices market. And then going on to retail, it's been mentioned already that this has probably been quite difficult for the market. You know, the COVID outbreak basically meant that all retail stores have actually closed, but this has led to many tenant voids, permanent closures, and of course CVAs. So although yes, you have a CVA and some stores will remain open, but there is like a cut in their income, and landlords are often left with what do we do. And if you're trying to sell retail in this market, just know it's quite difficult, because you're giving a lot of money up front for those voids. There are a lot of top-ups at the moment, which is quite tricky. So at the very start of lockdown, as you'd imagine, every deal that I had was pretty much aborted, because they're all again waiting until they had further clarity. And I think lockdown 2.0 will only just create like this. Well, basically this will be much worse than it was back in March. I think we'll have more store closures. I'm sure you've seen this morning that Sainsbury's will close quite a few of their stores and let about 4,000 people go. And that's just from a big, you know, grocer who's actually been open the entire time. So if you just think about all the retailers who have to close again for the next month, they'll definitely be hit hard. Once that affects your income, investors start to get very, very worried. But it goes without saying though, there are investment demands for RPI-linked supermarkets like Tesco's and Morrison's and Sainsbury's as well, for example, just in the London and South East, because their or investors' motive is basically driven by alternative use. So I don't know if you've heard of the Broadwalk in Edgware that was actually sold to Ballinmore Homes, because, of course, they want to create some regeneration in Edgware and put some residential units there. So although retail, we don't have that much income and not that much investment, but if you think about the assets where there is alternative use potential, you'll probably have some more investors looking towards that strategy rather than seeing what their current, you know, the unit holders and the retailers are going to do in future. But yeah, that's it for me.
Excellent. Thank you, Elizabeth. I think that gives us a clear picture of the uncertainty and the challenges that we're going to face going forward, but also I think the opportunities. So Craig has asked me to say a little bit about the course, so I'm going to keep this very brief, I promise. The important things, so we have two intakes in a year, September, and obviously for you, February next year will be the next opportunity. The entry requirements, we normally ask for a minimum of a 2-1 honours degree or equivalent. It can be in any subject. We don't assume any prior knowledge of real estate. But I would say that one of the things we're finding from a lot of our applicants is they often come to us with substantial relevant real estate-based work experience or something that is transferable. So if you do meet the academic requirements, brilliant. If you don't panic. If you've got work experience, then that's a conversation we should probably have. That's probably all I want to say on that, Craig. So
yeah.
So let me tell you a bit about how studying works. And I think Elizabeth will know this is the this is kind of a generic idea. This is how in principle it works, but it can be a bit more flexible. But essentially, you study a number of taught units, which are all 20 credits, and you study those in 10-week blocks. So it's 200 hours of study in total, or roughly 20 hours a week. So it is a reasonably substantial commitment. The last thing you do is a project-based inquiry, which is a bit like a small dissertation. It's a research project, but the key about it is we generally want you, where that's appropriate, to base it on practice and particularly your own experience so that you can embed it in what you're doing and either use it to progress within your organization or to reflect on something you're doing within your organization, or indeed to use it as a gateway to your career development. So as I say, it's 10 weeks and there are 8 weeks of what we might call taught material, which is online stuff like recorded lectures, written material, discussion board questions, all sorts of things like that. And then the final assessment, which usually makes up at least 50% of the unit, you have 2 weeks to work on that before you submit that. So you have a bit of headspace once you've kind of studied and absorbed all the knowledge to apply it to the assessment. And of course, that's supported by connection with the tutors through webinars, email, and various other mechanisms, discussion board being another one. Thank you, Craig. Next one, please.
Yep.
So this is primarily online, but it is a blended learning program. We recognize there are some benefits of, well, ideally face-to-face contact that just can't be achieved through the online approach that I've just described. So over the 2 year period, you'll engage with two conferences each year, four in total, and each conference is linked to a pair of units, which I've listed here. But I guess, and one of the challenges we've experienced is how we run these conferences in a COVID era. And so those have been online rather than face-to-face, but we will go face-to-face as soon as we can. But I think there are still benefits in terms of, you know, we get practitioners engaged and people who are really out there in the market doing this stuff to come in and talk to the students and you know, address current issues. It's an opportunity for networking. It's also an opportunity, of course, to engage with the staff and meet them face-to-face and get some personal feedback if that's what you are looking for. So there are a number of opportunities. So it's a blended approach to try and give you the best of both, allowing you to study around your other commitments, but still having some face-to-face elements, but without a major commitment.
Sure.
Thanks, Craig.
Okay. So yeah, following on from what Mark said there, if you do have some questions around the conference or around the course and the units Mark mentioned there, you can get in touch with me. You might have some questions around the assessment methods that the team used during each unit, and by all means reach out to me and I can ask those questions with Mark and the relevant academics. Or you might have questions around your eligibility for the course, fees, all of the stuff that you might be thinking about before submitting an application to us. That's my contact email address there. So please do send through any questions that you have and I'll be happy to answer them. And I think, Mark, am I right in thinking now that we can open the floor up to any questions that people might have?
Yes, absolutely. If anybody would like to pop a question in the chat, we'll try and respond.
Yeah. And if people don't have any questions now, and I mentioned at the start there around watching this back, I will send the recording out. Obviously, people will be probably really keen to hear what the panel had to say again, and a question might pop up. Please do feel free to me, and I do have the contact details of our panel, so I can send them the questions that you have. We don't seem to have had any questions come through, so from me, I would just like to thank all of our panel for a fantastic session today. We really do appreciate your time that you've given us. And I think the content that you've each delivered today has been really fascinating. I would imagine very useful to our potential applicants. Mark, I'd just like to hand over to you for some final words.
I was just going to say thank you particularly to Elizabeth, Hattie and Connor for giving up their time. They are, clearly a credit to us and a credit to themselves. And, I think that what they've had to share, I found really interesting and helpful. So if you have any questions going forward, if they're about course content or omissions, and Craig can't answer them, he'll ping them over to me anyway. So contact Craig in the first instance, and we'll definitely make sure that we respond to those soon as we can. We are inevitably working from home at the moment, which has its challenges, but at least I avoided the cat walking across the keyboard today, so that's an improvement. But I look forward to seeing some of you in the near future. Thanks very much.
Thanks very much, everybody.